بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم حديث 191 وعن أبي ذر رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا قام أحدكم في الصلاة فلا يمسح الحصى فإن الرحمة تواجهه رواه الخمسة بإسناد صحيح وزاد أحمد واحدة أو دع وفي الصحيح عن معيقب نحوه بغير تعليل. From Abu Dharr that the Prophet said, when one of you stands in the prayer, then he must not wipe the stone or the pebble, because the rahmah is facing him. And in a version of Ahmad, that if he has to wipe the stone, then it should be only one or do not wipe at all. The hadith is authentic and it has a similar version in the Sahih, except this addition, فَإِنَّ الرَّحْمَةَ تُوَاجِهُ, because the rahmah is facing him, is weak in the Sunan. So from the narration we take that it is makruh to wipe off any stone or dust or pebbles that may be clinging onto your forehead because of the sajda. Just like it is makruh also to wipe it from the place of sajda on the ground. And if you have to wipe the stone or the dust from the ground in order to level out the ground for your sajda, then the Prophet has given you permission to move only one pebble at most. What is the reason for the Prophet prohibiting you from wiping the ground and flattening it out? Some ulama say the reason is given in the Sunan, that the rahmah is facing you, and so in this place of your prayer and your prostration there is rahmah, so you don't want to move this rahmah away from you, which is on the pebbles or the stone. Other scholars have said it is because this is unnecessary movement in the prayer, and it will detract your khushu' and your submissiveness in the prayer when you make unnecessary movements like this. Rather, if you are praying in a bumpy place or a place which has stones and pebbles, then it would be better for you to smoothen it out before the prayer, so you don't do it during the prayer, because you don't want to be making unnecessary movements outside the salah. And if during the prayer you have to wipe away some of the pebbles or the stone, then at most you're allowed only one. So that is permissible. Anything more than one would be makruh. But most scholars say it is not haram. So they say the matter is of karaha, not hurma. So if you must move a pebble or a stone, then at most one. Anything more than that is makruh. Hadith 192. وعن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت سألت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الالتفات في الصلاة فقال هو اختلاس يختلسه الشيطان من صلاة العبد رواه البخاري وللترمذي عن أنس وصححه إياك والالتفات في الصلاة فإنه هلكة فإن كان لا بد ففي التضوع. From Aisha, she says, I asked the Prophet about looking away from side to side in the salah, and he replied, this is the shaitan snatching away from the prayer of the slave, or the shaitan is stealing the prayer of the slave. Bukhari reported it, and in At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet is reported to have said, beware of looking side to side in the salah, because it is a destruction. But if you must look away from side to side, then let it be in the nawafil prayers, or the optional prayers. The version in At-Tirmidhi is da'if. So we take from this hadith that it is makruh to look from side to side in the salah. Rather, you should be looking at one point alone, and preferably this should be the point of the sajda, or somewhere on the ground, so that the surrounding does not disturb you and distract your attention. If you have to look around because of a need, then there's no problem in this, and it's permissible. And it's reported in the Sunan that the Prophet was praying in Jama'ah with his companions, and during the prayer the Prophet was looking towards the mountain pathway, because he had sent a horseman to keep guard. So he was looking towards that mountain pathway where he sent his horsemen. So here there is a need, so it is not makruh. And this iltifat, or looking away, can be done with the head and the neck movement. As for him turning his whole body away from the qibla, then if he turns it to such a degree that it completely turns away from the qibla, then his prayer is broken. Because we know that one of the conditions for your prayer to be correct is that you must be facing the qibla all throughout the prayer. So let's say if the Kaaba is to the southeast from where you are living, if you turn your whole body, not just the neck and the head, but rather the whole body, so much so that it turns beyond the east point, then your prayer is broken. And likewise, if you turn it so much that it goes beyond the south point, then again your prayer is broken. Because remember, your qibla would be anything between the east and the south. Because we said that the qibla is a flexible issue. As for turning your head and neck when you make iltifat, if this is done for a reason, then it is not makruh. Otherwise, it is makruh. And the reason why al-iltifat is makruh is because it detracts from your khushu' of the prayer. Remember, you are in privacy with Allah, so you need to keep still and tranquil. And so this looking away to the left or the right, which is al-iltifat, is from the plots of shaitan. He wants to try to get you to look away and hence detract the reward of your prayer. So he could detract your khushu' by whispering into you some worldly thoughts, or by perhaps whispering into you that you may have broken your wudu, or by perhaps trying to get you to look around. And most scholars say it is makruh and it does not break your prayer, because it does not reach the level of breaking the prayer, unless it be that your whole body turns so much that you are no longer within the flexible range of the qibla. And it makes no difference whether the prayer is a nafila or a farida. The iltifat is makruh in both, because the hadith in al-Tirmidhi is da'if. So whenever you are praying, do not allow the shaitan to interrupt your privacy with your Lord. And you must focus greatly on your khushu' in the prayer. We can also take from this narration the fa'idah of the virtue of Aisha radiallahu anha, in that she asked the Prophet about some beneficial knowledge which she can implement. And this goes to show how eager she was to practice this deen properly. And how eager she was also, in particular, to pray properly. And this is a lesson which all Muslims can learn nowadays. Because all too often you find Muslims not praying properly and not having the proper khushu'. So in the Sahaba, we have a goodly example of how to pray properly and seek beneficial knowledge. Hadith 193, وعن أنس رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا كان أحدكم في الصلاة فإنه يناجي ربه فلا يبصقن بين يديه ولا عن يمينه ولكن عن شماله تحت قدمه متفق عليه وفي رواية أو تحت قدمه. From Anas that the Prophet said, when one of you is in the prayer, then he is in a private consultation with his Lord. So he must not spit to his right hand side in front of him, nor to his right hand side, but rather he can spit to his left hand side under his foot, muttafaqun alayh, and in a wording, or under his foot. So we learn from this hadith that your salah is your private connection with your Lord 5 times a day. And it makes no difference whether this is a fariḍa or a nafila. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَأَقِمِ الصَّلَاةَ لِذِكْرِي, and establish the prayer for my remembrance. So because you are remembering your Lord and you are undergoing this connection between you and your Creator, it is vital that you exhibit praiseworthy etiquettes. And from your praiseworthy etiquettes in the prayer is not to spit in front of you nor to your right hand side. You should not spit in front of you because your Lord is in front of you in the prayer. So Allah Jalla wa Ala is close to you and in front of you, despite the fact that we know He is above His throne, separate from the heavens. And also he should not spit on his right hand side, and this is an honoring towards the right hand side. And in a narration it says that there is an angel on the right hand side. And in another wording in Ibn Abi Shayba, it says that the good deeds are on the right hand side. So we find you have an angel and good deeds on the right hand side, and generally you honor the right hand side. So you do not spit to the right. However, we also know that to your left hand side is also an angel. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, إِذْ يَتَلَقَّ الْمُتَلَقِّيَانِ عَنِ الْيَمِينِ وَعَنِ الشِّمَالِ قَعِيدٌ. When those who receive him on the right and on the left, sitting down. So this is talking about the malaika. So how is it then that you are allowed to spit on the left hand side? Is this not a disrespect to the angel on the left? The answer is that, first of all, you should not spit in the prayer except if you need to. Maybe you have a cold and some phlegm comes out and you need to get rid of this phlegm. So obviously you need to spit this out. So this now would be a case of necessity, because you cannot pray with phlegm in your mouth. And so now you don't have a choice, you need to spit. So if you have to spit anywhere, then let it be to the left, because the right is more honorable. And likewise the front is more honorable, because this is the direction in which Allah Jalla wa Ala is. Also, we learn from the narration that he spits to the left under his foot. So it's not totally to the left, but rather it is under his left foot. And this would be the best way of doing it. Otherwise, we know in the other wording, it says spit to your left or under his foot. So upon that, you can spit underneath any one of your foot, right or left. Or you can spit to the left. So perhaps the best way, if we want to combine everything, is to spit under the left foot. And the Muslim must not think from this hadith that Allah Jalla wa'ala is physically in front of him. This is not true. So when Allah Jalla wa'ala is with you, it means He's with you in His rububiyyah. So it means He has full knowledge of you, He hears you, He sees you, He knows your inner thoughts, He knows your intentions, He knows what you will do, He has full control and power and authority over you. And nothing you can do can be done except with His permission. So He's with you in terms of His rububiyyah. Otherwise, it cannot be said that He is physically near you. Otherwise, if you want to know the direction of Allah, then we say that Allah has the direction of highness. Wherever you are, He is above you. Of course, this is difficult to make sense of physically. So if you're in Australia and Allah is above you, then if you're in Britain, does this mean that Allah is beneath you because Australia is down under? The answer is no. Wherever you are in the heavens and the earth, Allah is above you. Of course, scientifically, it is difficult to see how that is until you realize that Allah Jalla wa'ala is not bound by the laws of time and space. This is what makes Him divine. This hadith does seem to clash with another hadith in the Sahihain in which the Prophet والسلام, said, "Al-busaq fi al-masjid khati'a wa kaffaratuha dafnuha." That spitting in the masjid is a sin and its expiation is that you should bury this spit under the ground. So when you're praying in the masjid, it means you're not allowed to spit. But the hadith of the chapter is telling us that you are allowed to spit in your prayer to the left hand side or under your foot. But if you were to do this, it necessarily means you would be spitting in the masjid. So what's the solution to this then, if you're praying in the masjid and you have to spit? Do we say that this hadith is an exception to the general rule? So you are allowed to spit in the prayer, but on the left hand side or under your foot, and that this will not be classified as a sin? So it is an exception to the general rule? The better answer would be no. Rather, if you have to spit in the masjid, then spit on your clothing and then rub the clothing together. Because this is actually the sunnah, and it is what the Prophet ordered us to do. That if you have to spit, then spit on your clothing and then rub the clothing together to get rid of the mark of the spit. And so from this it becomes known that Islam orders cleanliness and for you to look presentable. Both your physical appearance and also the appearance of the place in which you are in. So the masjid needs to be nice and tidy and clean, and people must not spit in the masjid. Because first of all, this is untidy, and it is opposing the Islamic virtues of cleanliness, and secondly, it is a disrespect to the masjid. Masjid is the house of Allah, and you go and spit in it, you would not like it if somebody came to your house and spat. So how about then the house of Allah Jalla wa'ala? And the masajid are the most beloved places to Allah. Hadith 194, وعن أنس رضي الله عنه قال كان قرام لعائشة رضي الله عنها سترت به جانب بيتها فقال لها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أميطي عنا قرامك هذا فإنه لا تزال تصاويره تعرض لي في صلاتي رواه البخاري واتفق على حديثها في قصة أنب جانية أبي جهم وفيه فإنها ألهتني عن صلاتي. From Anas, he says that Aisha had a curtain which would cover a part of her house. So the Prophet said to her, remove this curtain of yours from us because its images or its pictures which were on it are presented to me in my salah, meaning they are distracting me in my prayer. Bukhari reported it, and in the Sahihain, the Prophet was praying with a clothing with stripes on it, and this distracted him in the prayer, meaning the pattern. And he said after the prayer, to bring me the ambijaniya of Abu Jaham. This is the rough clothing which will not distract him in the prayer. And Abu Jaham is one of the Sahabi. He gave the Prophet a clothing with some patterns on it as a gift. And so when this distracted the Prophet, he said that this has distracted me from my prayer. So we take from both of these narrations that the Musalli needs to be far away from anything which will distract him, be it on his clothing or in his environment. So this could be in terms of patterns, it could be in terms of bright colors, or anything of that sort, anything which will distract him. And the reason, again, should be clear, because it will take away the khushu' from your prayer. And the whole essence of the prayer is the khushu'. Otherwise, without al-khushu', your prayer will simply become a series of exercise movements. Also, we take from the fawa'id of this hadith to enjoin the good and forbid the evil, because the Prophet ordered Aisha to remove this curtain from the house. So the man is obliged to enjoin the good and forbid the evil in his household. And we take from the hadith that the Prophet can also become distracted in his prayer, although this distraction is not such so as to completely distract him from the prayer, but rather these would be certain thoughts which would come to his mind, but he will let go of them because of his discipline and return back to the focus in the prayer. We can also take from this hadith that you should not decorate the masajid in such a way which would distract the musalli. Masajid are just meant to be simple buildings in which you come to pray. But as for unnecessarily decorating them, then this needs to be avoided. So you might have patterns ingrained in the walls of the masajid and all other types of decorations. This is clearly not necessary and it will only distract the musalli. We take also that it is permissible to cover a wall with a curtain, because the Prophet only told her to remove the curtain because of the images. But it is better not to cover them with a curtain because of the hadith in Sahih Muslim in which he says, مَا أُمِرْتُ أَنْ أَكْسُوَ الْحِجَارَةَ وَالطِّينَ. I have not been ordered to clothe or cover the stone or the mud, meaning the walls made out of the stone or mud. And he said this to Aisha when he came back from an expedition and she had covered the door with a carpet. And this is because the Prophet ﷺ deemed this to be too much luxury, which goes against az-zuhd. We also take from the narrations that any thoughts which come to the mind of the musalli which distract him do not break the prayer off, because the Prophet did not restart the prayer. And so we can say that any place in which there are images which will distract you from the prayer, then this is not a place in which it is recommended to pray. And Shaykh al-Islam said that the scholars have said that to enter into a church and pray in there is makruh because of the images you find in the churches. And likewise with any place which has images in it. It has been reported, however, that the companions prayed in a church. So we say if you're going to pray in a church because you have no other choice, then at least cover up the images. Because remember, the prayer is sahih everywhere on the earth except when you have an evidence for an exception. Also, the ulama say it is makruh to face in your prayer anything which will distract you. So for example, a fire or a bright lamp or some kind of candle or anything which will distract you, because it will take away the khushu'. And some scholars say that you should not face a fire because it resembles the majus who worship the fire. As for images, then if these are images of things which have a soul in them, so we're talking about animals and humans, then the ulama have agreed that this is not permissible. And it makes no difference whether this is a statue or a still image. And some of the ulama, like Mujahid, the famous Mufassir, has said that even plants and trees, which are natural creations of Allah Jalla wa Ala and have a life in them, because plants do have a life, he says even these are impermissible. And he uses the hadith in the Sahihain, مَنْ أَظْلَمُ مِمَّنْ ذَهَبَ يَخْلُقُ كَخَلْقِ فَلْيَخْلُقْ ذَرَّةً أَوْ لِيَخْلُقْ شَعِيرَةً. That Allah says, who is more of a transgressor than the one who goes about creating my kind of creation? Then let him create a small ant, or let him create a grain of barley. So he says that the grain of barley is not from the animals or humans, but because it is something which Allah Jalla wa Ala exclusively creates, so humans are not allowed to make pictures of these either. So this is something which Allah exclusively creates. But as for something which humans can create, let's say a house or a computer, then this is something which humans can make an effort in, so these images are permissible. So this is a view of Mujahid and it is extremely strict. But most of the scholars say that just images of animals and humans are prohibited. And it should be noted that most of the scholars say that when it comes to toys of children, be it for play purposes or educational purposes, then these images, even if they are of humans or animals, then these are permissible. And we know in the Sunan that Aisha had a horse with two wings. And this is clearly an image of a living creature with a soul in it, which is a horse of course, and the Prophet ﷺ allowed this. There are ulama who have said that when it comes to these toys of the kids, then it is better that they do not look like real humans, just like you find nowadays. But then practically it's difficult to draw the line, which looks like a real human and which looks like a cartoony figure. So we can say it would be better if the toy does not look very human. However, when it comes to children's issues, then we can be more flexible, and Shaykh al-Islam says that the nature of kids is that they like to be distracted and play around. And so therefore we can be more flexible when it comes to children's issues. Hadith 195, وَعَنْ جَابِرْ إِبْنِ سَمُرَةٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ قَالَ قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لَيَنْتَهِيَنَّ أَقْوَامٌ يَرْفَعُونَ أَبْصَارَهُمْ إِلَى السَّمَاءِ فِي الصَّلَاةِ أَوْ لَا تَرْجِعُ إِلَيْهِمْ رواه مسلم وله عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول لا صلاة بحضرة طعام ولا وهو يدافعه الأخبثان. From Jabir ibn Samura that the Prophet said, certain people better refrain from raising their sights up to the sky in their prayer, or their vision will not return to them, meaning they'll become blind. Muslim reported it, and also he has from Aisha, who says that the Prophet says, there is no salah when food is served, nor when a person is desperate to relieve himself. So in both of these narrations, again, we find that al-khushu' is the essence of the prayer. So this is why the Prophet ﷺ has given a severe warning against raising your vision to the sky. Because this goes against the khushu' if you're looking left and right, and especially if you're looking upwards. Rather, you need to be looking straight down, preferably, and without your eyes wandering around. And also, when Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib saw a man who was fiddling about with his beard and his clothing, he said, if the heart of this man had khushu', then his limbs would also have khushu'. Because the fact that your limbs are playing about in the salah, or your eyes perhaps, it shows that your heart does not have khushu'. Because remember, your heart orders the rest of your body. So if your limbs don't have khushu', then this is a sure sign that your heart does not have khushu', and your heart is thinking about other things during the salah, which defeats the whole purpose of the salah. So this idea of al-iltifat, which is when you look around right and left, up and down, this needs to be avoided. And we spoke about this before. There is another narration, which is authentic, in which the Prophet ﷺ said, as part of a longer hadith, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَكُمْ بِالصَّلَاةِ فَإِذَا صَلَّيْتُمْ فَلَا تَلْتَفِتُوا فَإِنَّ اللَّهَ يَنْصِبُ وَجْهَهُ لِوَجْهِ عَبْدِهِ فِي صَلَاتِهِ مَا لَمْ يَلْتَفِتْ. And verily Allah has ordered you with the salah, so when you perform the salah, then do not make iltifat. Because Allah puts up His face in front of the face of His slave in the salah, as long as the slave does not make iltifat, look around. So does this now mean that every time a person looks upwards in the salah intentionally, then he will become blind? The answer is no, it may not necessarily happen. However, this hadith is a warning to warn against such an action, that it could happen. It can also mean that you will become spiritually blind. So you become blind to the truth, and you become blind to those things which will benefit you. And this will be actually a punishment for you in this world and in the hereafter. And so the real blindness is actually when your hearts become blind, not when your eyes become blind. As Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah Al-Hajj, فَإِنَّهَا لَا تَعْمَ الْأَبْصَارُ وَلَكِنْ تَعْمَ الْقُلُوبُ الَّتِي فِي الصُّدُورِ. For verily, the vision does not become blind, but it is the hearts in the chest which become blind. Likewise, Allah Jalla wa Ala says about the kuffar, وَلَهُمْ أَعْيُنٌ لَا يُبَصِرُونَ بِهَا. And they have eyes which they cannot see with. The point is, they can physically see, but if you cannot see the truth with your eyes, then what good are your eyes? So the point is, with this warning, we can take the faida that it is haram to intentionally look upwards in the sky during the prayer. And this is the opinion of most of these scholars. Otherwise, the madhab of Al-Imam Ahmad is that raising your eyes upwards in the salah is makruh and not haram. And so we find that you need to be extremely careful what you look at during your salah. Because the things you look at would be the things your heart will start to think about, and they will distract your heart. And this can even apply outside the prayer. This is why men and women are told to lower their gazes and not to look at the opposite gender. Because what you look at will affect the heart. Because your eyes and your ears, and more generally your five senses, are the gateway to the heart. So if you can protect these canals which lead to the heart, then you will be protecting the heart. On the topic of eyes in the prayer, the ulama say that it is makruh to close your eyes during the prayer. And so you pray with your eyes closed. They say this is makruh because it is an imitation of the Yahud. And also, when you close your eyes, it could make you sleepy. And definitely, closing the eyes in the prayer is not from the sunnah of the Prophet. If there is a need to close your eyes, for example, somebody passes in front or something happens which is distracting you, and you close your eyes so you avoid looking at it, then here we can say this is permissible because this is now for a specific reason. In fact, we could even say it is recommended in this case to close your eyes because having khushu' is necessary in the prayer. So here you can close your eyes. What about those who say that when I close my eyes, it gives me more khushu'? So in this case, some ulama say that there is no problem in closing your eyes. Other ulama say, no, you should still open your eyes because this is not a good enough reason to oppose the sunnah of the Prophet. And this khushu' which you might gain could still be from the shaitan, who does not want you to follow the sunnah. For example, the Sufiya indulge in their type of innovative dhikr, and they say that this gives them khushu' and tranquility. But this does not make their innovative dhikr permissible, because it goes against the sunnah. So we advise to keep your eyes open, unless it is a case of necessity where you must close your eyes in order to avoid being distracted. As for the narration of Aisha, then it is telling you that if you are desperate to relieve yourself, then you should do this first before praying. So if you have to relieve yourself and you don't find any water, so you would not be able to make wudu, but at this moment you are in a state of wudu, is it better for you to pray and then relieve yourself, because then at least you'll be praying in a state of wudu? Or is it better for you now to relieve yourself, make tayammum because you don't have water, and then pray? The answer without any doubt is the second, because praying with tayammum is perfectly permissible. However, praying when you are desperate to relieve yourself and hence you will have no khushu', then this is a blameworthy action. The word al-akhbathan used in the hadith is referring to the two impure substances, which is of course the urine and the feces. If you pray and you are desperate to relieve yourself, then your prayer is correct, however, the reward is deficient because of your lack of khushu'. Remember we said, quoting the evidence, that the level of reward of your salah is in accordance with the khushu'. The Zahiriyya say that if you have to relieve yourself and you are to pray, then your prayer is not sahih, because what you are doing is completely opposing this hadith. The majority of the ulama say that this hadith does not refer to your prayer being invalid, but rather it refers to your prayer being incomplete in terms of its reward. And we know in the authentic narration the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنِّي لَأَدْخُلُ فِي الصَّلَاةِ وَأُرِيدُ أَنْ أُطِيلَهَا فَأَسْمَعُ بُكَاءَ الصَّبِيِّ فَأَتَجَوَّزُ فِيهَا مَخَافَةَ أَنْ أَشُقَّ عَلَىٰ أُمِّهِ. That I enter into a prayer wanting to prolong it, but then I hear the crying of a baby, so I shorten the prayer out of fear that I will cause difficulty to the mother, because the mother is in the congregation praying. So clearly the crying of the baby is distracting the Prophet in his prayer, which will then make him shorten the prayer. So definitely this would detract from the khushu' when he hears the baby crying and he does not want to give difficulty to the mother or make the mother stressed, so he shortens the prayer. Despite this, the prayer is still correct. However, having said that, if you are so desperate to relieve yourself such that it reaches a level in which you are not performing the actions properly, so you're hurrying and rushing them so much that you don't have any tranquility in your actions, then of course you are missing one of the pillars of the prayer, which is at-tum'anina, which is when you're not relaxed in your actions. And this prayer is invalid because of the famous hadith of the musi, the one who prayed badly. He did not have any tum'anina in his actions. He was simply rushing his actions along. And the Prophet told him to go pray again because you have not prayed, which means that his prayer was invalid. So if it reaches that sort of level, that you cannot even perform the actions properly and you're rushing them so much, then in this case your prayer is invalid because it is missing one of the arkan, or one of the essential elements of the prayer, which is at-tum'anina. So it will become as if you are praying without reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. You have no prayer. Hadith 196. وَعَنْ أَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُ أَنَّ النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ قَالَ التَّثَاؤُبُ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ فَإِذَا تَثَاءَبَ أَحَدُكُمْ فليقضم ما استطاع. رواه مسلم والترمذي وزاد في الصلاة. From Abu Huraira that the Prophet said, yawning is from shaitan. So when one of you yawns, then let him resist it as much as he is able to. Muslim reported it, and in a version of At-Tirmidhi, he says, yawning in the salah. So yawning happens when your tiredness overcomes you, and it leads to you opening your mouth. So as long as this yawning is a result of your tiredness, then this is caused by shaitan. And this does not negate the fact that yawning could be scientifically explained. Rather, the Muslim acknowledges and accepts the scientific causes, but he also accepts the world of the unseen as informed to him by Allah Jalla wa Ala. Because when it comes to matters of the unseen, the Muslim's job is simply to hear and obey. Because there's no way he could possibly know about this except if he is informed by the one who knows. And the one who knows is obviously Allah Jalla wa Ala. So yawning is when shaitan will overcome you and make you open your mouth. And the shaitan would love the Muslim to be feeling lethargic all the time, so that he will not complete his obligatory duties. And also this image of you opening your mouth is a distasteful image. Hence, the Muslim is ordered to resist opening his mouth. And if it so happens that you have to open your mouth because shaitan overcomes you to open your mouth, then you need to cover your mouth with your hand. As in the hadith in the Sahih Muslim, إِذَا تَثَاءَبَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيُمْسِكْ بِيَدِهِ عَلَى فَمِهِ فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ يَدْخُلُ. When one of you yawns, then let him grab his mouth with his hand, because the shaitan enters. So if you don't cover your mouth, the shaitan will enter. And so we can take that Allah Jalla wa Ala wants the Muslim to be invigorated and in full strength, so that he can perform his acts of worship and do things which will please Allah Jalla wa Ala. And all of this requires energy, of course. You cannot do it when you are feeling lazy. And so the shaitan would want you to feel lazy. Also, if you do happen to yawn, then you need to make sure that first of all you cover your mouth, as we have just stated, but also you do not make a noise when you are yawning, because this will actually make shaitan laugh at you, as we find in the authentic hadith. In At-Tirmidhi, the Prophet is authentically reported to have said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْعِطَاسِ وَيَكْرَهُ التَّثَاؤُبِ. Allah loves sneezing and He hates yawning. فَإِذَا عَطَسَ أَحْدُكُمْ فَقَالَ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ فَحَقٌ عَلَى كُلِّ مَنْ سَمِعَهُ أَنْ يَقُولَ يَرْحَمُكَ اللَّهُ. So if one of you sneezes and then he says Alhamdulillah, then it is a right against everyone who hears him that he should say Yarhamukallah. So everyone who hears you say Alhamdulillah needs to say Yarhamukallah. And he goes on, وَأَمَّا التَّثَاؤُبُ فَإِذَا تَثَاءَبَ أَحَدُكُمْ فَلْيَرُدَّهُ مَا اسْتَطَاعَ وَلَا يَقُولْ هَا هَا فَإِنَّمَا ذَلِكَ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ يَضْحَكُ مِنْ. And as for yawning, then when one of you yawns, then let him resist it as much as he is able to. And he must not say, ha, ha, during the yawning, because that is from shaitan, he laughs at you. So we say, if you're going to yawn, option number one is to resist it. If you cannot resist it, then cover your mouth. And also make sure you do not make a noise when you are yawning, by saying, ah, ah. And why is this hadith in this chapter of Al-Khushu'? It's because in At-Tirmidhi it says, yawning in the salah. So this ruling of yawning applies in the salah as well as outside the salah. And being tired and yawning in the salah opposes the khushu'. And linked to this is also the idea that you should not pray when you are tired. So if you are feeling tired or you are suffering from some slumber, then you should take a rest first. Even if it is a light sleep, let's say of 10 to 15 minutes, then when you wake up, you will actually find yourself to be extremely energetic, even with a small sleep. Actually, you may well find that if you wake up from a longer sleep, then you are actually feeling tired, as if you need to sleep more. And if you were to wake up from a short sleep, then you feel energetic. And this is something which is experienced by many people. So if this is the case, take a small break or a rest, even if it is a small nap, and you'll find yourself to be completely invigorated, ready for the salah. And the Prophet ﷺ said in the Sahih, إِذَا نَعَسَ أَحَدُكُمْ فِي الصَّلَاةِ فَلْيَرْقُدْ حَتَّى يَذْهَبَ عَنْهُ النَّوْمُ فَإِنَّ أَحَدَكُمْ إِذَا صَلَّى وَهُوَ نَاعِسْ لَعَلَّهُ يَذْهَبُ يَسْتَغْفِرُ فَيَصُبُّ نَفْسَهُ. When one of you is sleepy in his prayer, then let him go to sleep until his sleepiness goes away from him. Because one of you could come up and pray in a slumber state, and he begins to seek forgiveness, but he ends up abusing his own self. And this is because he does not know what he's saying, because he's so sleepy. And if it happens to be the case that the prayer time is about to run out, or you have to attend the Salat al-Jama'ah in the masjid, and you are feeling sleepy, then if you make wudu, especially with ice cold water, then you should find that it will do the trick nicely. So this concludes the chapter on khushu'. Al-Hafidh ibn Hajar rahimahullah did not mention anything about the niyyah, your intention in the prayer, despite the fact that your intention is one of the conditions for your prayer to be correct. The famous hadith for the intention is the hadith of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, in which the Prophet said that your deeds are done by your intention, and every person will have what he intends. So he's saying here that you would not be doing any action unless you previously intended to do it. So all actions are by intention. They have to have an intention. And an-niyyah in the Arabic language means al-qasd, which is when you want to do something, or you intend to do something, or perhaps you set out to do something. And technically it is when you make a firm resolution to perform an action. And your intention is of two types. Firstly, the intention of the actual act of worship, and this distinguishes it from a normal action. So you would intend in your heart that this is the Salat al-Dhuhr, as opposed to any other salah, or perhaps this is Salat al-Asr as opposed to anything else. So this is more pertaining to the fiqh matters. Then there is the second type of niyyah, which is when you intend the pleasure of Allah Jalla wa'ala, and you intend to gain close to Him. And this is less pertaining to fiqh, and this is more to do with purification of the soul. But both ingredients are essential. Many a time we find Muslims just pay attention to the first ingredient of the niyyah, and not the second one. But you must always have in mind that you are doing this to please Allah, and you are doing this to gain close to Him. And remember that no act of worship could be accepted from you until it is done solely for Allah Jalla wa'ala, so for His pleasure alone, and in accordance with the Sunnah of the Prophet. So when you are performing your acts of worship, any act of worship, you need to have these two elements in mind. You need to feel that you are imitating the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and you are following your Prophet. And also you need to have in mind that you are doing this for Allah, seeking closeness to Him. It needs to be noted that in no act of worship do you utter your intention out aloud, and that the niyyah is done in the heart. And the niyyah is a simple issue. Whenever you want to do something, you have made your niyyah. So it happens automatically without any effort. And opposing your intention solely for Allah is ar-riya, showing off. So if you're doing your act of worship in order to gain praise from the other people, then this completely destroys your ikhlas. Ikhlas is when you do an act of worship solely to gain close to Allah and to earn His pleasure. Niyyah is a big topic, but one of the important issues in the niyyah is, if you are praying a fard salah, within this salah are you allowed to change your niyyah and make it into a nafilah? The answer is, we have some detail on this issue. If it is from a fard to a particular nafilah, for example one of the rawatib, then this is not permissible, and if you change your intention, then the whole salah becomes batila. So you have to start all over again. If you're praying any nafila and you change your intention for it to become a fard, so let's say you're praying a 2 rak'ah nafila and you change your intention for this to become the 2 rak'ah of the salat al-subh, which is a fard, then this is not permissible and your prayer becomes batila. If you change your intention from one particular sunnah to another particular sunnah, let us say from Salat al-Duha, you change your intention to Salat al-Fajr, which is one of the rawatib, because when you're praying Salat al-Duha, you realize that you forgot to pray the rawatib of the Salat al-Fajr. So this will break your prayer, because one particular sunnah to another particular sunnah is not permissible. The only change of intention which you can have is if you change from a fard salah or a particular sunnah to an absolute sunnah. An absolute sunnah meaning just a sunnah which is not done for any particular reason. So if you're praying a Salat al-Fard and you change your intention for it to become just a normal sunnah which is not done for any particular reason, then this is permissible. And the difference is because when you're praying the Salat al-Fard, then your intention is actually composed of two things. First of all, the intention to pray, and secondly, the intention to pray that particular Fard prayer. As for the absolute sunnah, then your intention is simply to pray, but it is not any particular prayer. So if you change now from fard to an absolute sunnah, then you're just letting go of that second part of your niyyah, which is the intention to pray that particular prayer. You're letting that go, which leaves you with the first part of your intention, which is just to pray. But the other way around does not work, because if you're praying an absolute sunnah and you upgrade to a fard, then you're actually now adding in a second part of the intention, which is that particular fard prayer. And that is not allowed, because you need to have done that before you start the prayer. As for changing the intention between a fard and a particular sunnah, then when you're praying a particular sunnah, let us say Salatul Duha, then in Salatul Duha you have made your intention first of all to pray, and secondly to particularly pray Salatul Duha. So if you now upgrade this to a fard prayer, then you are changing the second part of this intention and replacing it with the intention to pray a fard. So this ruptures the second part of your intention, and seeing as though the intention needs to be held all throughout the prayer for the prayer to be correct, then it holds that if you change this intention, then you've broken the intention actually. So it is like you breaking your wudu during the prayer. Hence it breaks the prayer completely. So the only way that changing the intention can work is if you change your intention from a particular sunnah to an absolute sunnah, that's fine, or from a fard to an absolute sunnah, that's also fine. Any other way around will break the prayer completely and you have to start again, and it will be as if you have broken your wudu in the prayer. Then Al-Hafiz said, Babul Masajid, the chapter of the Masajid. First of all, the word Al-Masajid is the plural of Masjid, and in the language it means the place in which you prostrate or make your sujood. The word Sajda in the language means to be humble or lowly and submissive. We know that the whole earth is fit to be a masjid, as we quoted the famous Sahih Hadith. And so the whole earth is a masjid except the places which have been specified. But what is intended when he says the chapter of the masajid are the particular buildings built specifically for the prayer to Allah Jalla wa'ala. In the glory days of Al-Islam, masajid used to be not just places of prayer, but rather places of education, where the ulama would frequent, and you would always find circles of knowledge in the masajid. This used to be the way of the early Muslims. So you would find the student of knowledge enter the masjid and take part in the circles of knowledge, and he would leave the masjid as someone who is knowledgeable, someone who has the fear of Allah and is purified from his sins and has adorned himself with the methodology of Al-Islam. Also, the masajid would be places to prepare the Muslim army. So the leaders would be chosen, the army would be prepared, and any news of conquests would be received in the masajid. So you can see that the masajid would play a pivotal role in the life of the Muslim, and it would be at the root and heart of the Muslim community. But nowadays, we find a complete contrast when the Muslims have turned away from their deen and gone chasing after the pleasures of this world. It meant that they deserted the masajid, and the masajid did not occupy a high status in the hearts of the Muslims as it once did. So now you only find the masajid populated by a few people, and therefore it is no surprise that the status of the Muslims has been reduced and they have become weak in the land, as is apparent. Likewise, the divisions within the Muslims are more than they have ever been. So if the Muslims want honor, just like our predecessors did, then it is upon the Muslims of this day and age to return back to the masajid, to populate them, to have active circles of knowledge with scholars coming in and delivering lectures and circles, just like they used to do. Because this izzah, or this honor, is with Allah Jalla wa'ala alone. As he says, فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. All of the honor is with Allah. And the last part of this ummah cannot be rectified except that which rectified the first part of this ummah. And it is clear for us to see that the masajid played a pivotal role in the rectification of the first part of this ummah. Therefore, it does not take a genius to realize that if this part of the ummah, the last part, is to be rectified, then the masajid must be given life. So if the Muslims want a high status in this world, such that their enemies fear them, then first and foremost, the masajid need to occupy a high status in the hearts of the Muslims, which at the moment they do not. So we find Al-Hafidh has quoted here a series of ahadith pertaining to Al-Masajid. Hadith number 197, عن عائشة رضي الله عنها قالت أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ببناء المساجد في الدور وأن تنظف وتطيب. رواه أحمد وأبو داود والترمذي وصحح إرساله. From Aisha, she says that the Prophet ordered that the masajid be built in the areas which people are living, so in the populated areas, and that the masajid should be cleansed from any dirt or impurity and also be perfumed. The narration is sahih. So from this narration we find that the masajid need to be made in places where many people are living. So this would be towns and cities. It would not be countryside, because we do not have a concentrated number of people normally living in the countryside. And seeing as though the idea of the masajid is to bring the people together, then it only makes sense that it should be built in places where there are many people. And this idea of building a masjid in itself is extremely virtuous, as we find the hadith in the Sahih, مَنْ بَنَى مَسْجِدًا بَنَى اللَّهُ لَهُ مِثْلَهُ فِي الْجَنَّةِ. Whoever builds a masjid, then Allah will build something like it for him in Jannah, meaning a house for him in Jannah. And this is where your reward is of the same type as your actions. So you built the house of Allah, and Allah built for you a house in Jannah. There is a second interpretation to this hadith, which appears to be less likely, but nevertheless we'll mention it. They say that building the masajid in the dur, they say dur means houses, which it does, because a dar means house, and the plural is dur, which are houses. So what they say is that in each house you need to have a specific area for the prayer. So it's like a mini masjid in your house. And this would be for the nawafil prayers, and also where the women could pray their fard prayers, because women don't have to go to the masjid. For this interpretation, they take another narration to support it, and this is found in the Sahihain, where Utban ibn Malik asked the Prophet ﷺ to come to his house and perform a prayer there, because he wanted to take that place as a masjid in his house where he would be performing the salah. Because Utban himself could not go to the masjid, because it was far away. And so the Prophet ﷺ acceded to his request. And the Prophet came and he asked him, which place do you want? And he pointed out the place. And the Prophet ﷺ prayed a 2-raka nafila salah in jama'ah. So it also proves that sometimes you can pray a nafila salah in jama'ah. But there's no doubt that the first interpretation is definitely the stronger, and it is more in agreement with what is apparent from the narration, is that the masajid need to be built in populated areas. And there is no doubt also that you need to use your houses to perform the prayer as well. Because if you do not perform prayers in your houses, and we're talking about the nawafil prayers, then you will make your houses resemble graveyards. Because of course we know that it is the graveyards in which you do not perform prayers. It is prohibited. So do not turn your houses into graveyards by not performing prayers in your houses. Of course we're talking about the nawafil prayers, because if you're living close enough to the masjid, then the Salat al-Jama'ah would be wajib upon you. Also we take from the narration that the masajid must be kept clean and also must be perfumed. This will attract the people to come to the masjid. Imagine if the masajid are dirty or they smell. This will repel people from coming to the masjid, and they will start to make excuses to avoid the Salat al-Jama'ah. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says, وَعَهِدْنَا إِلَىٰ إِبْرَاهِيمَ وَإِسْمَعِيلَ أَنْ طَهِّرَا بَيْتِيَ لِلطَّائِفِينَ وَالْعَاكِفِينَ وَالرُّكَّعِ السُّجُودِ. And when we ordered Ibrahim and Ismail to purify my house for those making tawaf, those making i'tikaf, and those making ruku' and sujood. So you need to keep the masajid clean and smelling fresh. And this is all part of honoring the emblem of Allah, as he says, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ حُرُمَاتِ اللَّهِ فَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَّهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ. And whoever venerates the sacred things of Allah, then this is better for him with his Lord. Likewise, وَمَنْ يُعَظِّمْ شَعَائِرَ اللَّهِ فَإِنَّهَا مِنْ تَقْوَى الْقُلُوبِ. Whoever venerates the emblems of Allah, then this is from the taqwa of the heart. And cleaning and perfuming the masajid is from venerating the masajid. And as for coming into the masajid and there is an offensive stench coming from you, then this is haram. And the Prophet ﷺ forbade those who eat uncooked onions, garlic and leek to come to the masjid, because these will give off an offensive smell, as is well known. And he said that the malaika are offended with that which offends the people. So therefore, it is the right of the Imam of the Masjid to kick out anyone who comes into the Masjid and he stinks. It doesn't have to be specifically smelling of onions or garlic or leek. Just any offensive smell is good enough for the Imam to kick this person out of the Masjid. Hadith 198. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم قاتل الله اليهود
اتخذوا قبور أنبيائهم مساجد.
متفق عليه وزاد مسلم والنصارى. ولهما من حديث عائشة كان إذا مات فيهم الرجل الصالح بنوا على قبره مسجدا وفيه أولئك الشرار الخلق. From Aisha that the Prophet said, may Allah curse the Yahud and Nasara. They took the graves of their prophets as masajid, or places of prayer. That's in the Sahihain. And also, they have the Prophet saying that when a righteous man would die amongst them, they would build on his grave a masjid. And it says that they are the worst of creation. As for the first narration from Abu Huraira, then this is what the Prophet said approaching the time of his own death. And the reason why he said this near his own death should be obvious enough. He's warning his ummah not to take his grave as a place of prayer or a masjid, because this will lead to shirk, and this is what led to the downfall of the nations before us. As for the second narration from Aisha, Al-Hafidh did not quote the whole of it. We find in the Sahihain that Habiba and Salama, the two wives of the Prophet, were in Habasha, and they were in a church. And they saw in this church many images. And they narrated this to the Prophet. And the Prophet told them, إِنَّ أُولَٰئِكَ إِذَا كَانَ فِيهِمْ الرَّجُلُ الصَّالِحِ فَمَاتَ بَنَوْا عَلَىٰ قَبْرِهِ مَسْجِدًا وَفِيهِ تِلْكَ الصُّوَرِ أُولَٰئِكَ شِرَارُ الْخَلْقِ عِنْدَ اللَّهِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ. He said, these are the people, when a righteous person would die, they would build on his grave a masjid, or a place of prayer, and they would put these images in this masjid. They are the worst of creation with Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And they are the worst of creation because, first of all, they've turned a grave into a masjid, which is haram and it leads to shirk. And secondly, the sin of putting up images of righteous people, and this again leads to shirk. So they've done two things which both lead to shirk. So it's only fitting that they should be the worst of creation with Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And we can also take that it is haram to have pictures and images in the masajid, indeed anywhere else, but particularly in masajid, if you have images of righteous people, there you are simply asking for shirk to be introduced after a period of time. Because when ignorance becomes widespread, then the people will start to think that these images of righteous people are to be worshipped. And this is exactly how shirk first began, and the reason why Allah Jalla wa Ala sent Nuh alayhi salam to his people. And this is where you find the people of Nuh alayhi salam saying, وَقَالُوا لَا تَذَرُنَّ آلِهَتَكُمْ وَلَا تَذَرُنَّ وَدًّا وَلَا سُوَاعٌ وَلَا يَغُوثَ وَيَعُوقَ وَنَسْرًا. They said, do not leave your gods, do not leave Wad, nor Suwa', nor Yaghuth, nor Ya'uq, nor Nasr. And these five names are names of their gods, but actually these five were names of righteous people who used to live amongst them. And when they died, they set up images of these righteous people to remind the people to follow in the footsteps of these righteous men. But through time, as knowledge got lost and shaitan whispered into the people that your forefathers actually used to worship these statues, so you should also make dua to these statues. And so the people then moved from making dua to Allah to making dua to these statues or these images of righteous people. And it makes no difference whether this image is a photo or a drawn image or a statue. An image is an image. And we can also take that it is haram to bury the dead in a masjid or to build a masjid on a grave. So either way, the end result is the same, is that you have a masjid with a grave in it. And in fact, a masjid with a grave in it is not called a masjid strictly, it is called a mashhad, a mausoleum. And so in mausoleums, the prayer is not correct, because it holds true that you are praying in a graveyard, and we discussed the hadith before, that the whole earth is a masjid except the maqbara and the hammam. And we take that anyone who buries a dead person in a masjid or builds a masjid on a grave or puts images of righteous people in a masjid, then He is going to be from the worst of creation with Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah. And also he is resembling the Yahud and Nasara. And we take that it is permissible to send the curse of Allah on the kuffar as a whole, if there is a particular reason for doing so. Because here, the Prophet is sending the curse upon the Yahud and Nasara as a whole. He's not specifying any one particular person. And so we must make sure that we do not go to extremes in venerating the graves. Even so much as putting flowers on graves should not be done, because there is no need to do so. And it will lead to people exaggerating in graves and also building mausoleums. Hadith 199. وعن أبي هريرة رضي الله عنه قال بعث النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم خيلا فجاءت برجل فربطوه بسارية من سوار المسجد. الحديث متفق عليه. From Abu Huraira he says that the Prophet sent some horsemen and they came with a man and they tied him up to one of the pillars of the masjid. Up until the end of the hadith. متفق عليه. So this person they came with, his name is Thumama ibn Uthal. He was from the chiefs of the tribe of Banu Hanifa. And so the Muslims captured him. And they came with him and tied him up to the pillar of the masjid. Al-Hafid has just quoted a piece of the narration. Otherwise the story of Thumama ibn Uthal is found in the Sahihain. And it is a wonderful story for every Muslim to read, a real heart melter. But as far as the rulings are concerned, we take that it is permissible to bring a kafir into the masjid and tie him up against the pillars. And also, any non-Muslim can enter the masjid for a need. And the kuffar used to enter the masajid and speak to the Prophet ﷺ. So for example, if you have a non-Muslim who is perhaps cleaning the masjid, then this is permissible. As for this idea of mushrikeen entering the masajid, then some scholars say that mushrikeen are not allowed to enter the masajid absolutely. And they quote the ayah in Surah At-Tawbah, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ نَجَسٌ فَلَا يَقَرَبُوا الْمَسْجِدَ الْحَرَامَ بَعْدَ عَامِهِمْ هَذَا. Or you who believe the mushrikeen are najas, meaning their faith is impure, so let them not approach the masjid al-haram after this year of theirs. And so the prohibition is actually directed to the Haram of Mecca. They're not allowed in the Haram of Mecca. And not just specifically the Masjid al-Haram. And they say that the ruling applies to all masajid. As for Al-Imam Ahmad, he says that the mushrikeen are not allowed in the Haram of Mecca. Neither are they allowed in all the other masajid except for a need. Such that if they have to fix the masjid, for example. Or if he's a builder, or if he's a cleaner, or the like. And there's no doubt that for a particular need, the non-Muslims are allowed in the masjid. For example, we have the A'rabi, the countryside Arab, who came to the masjid to ask about Islam. We have the Yahud who came to the Prophet in the masjid and they told the Prophet that a man and a woman from them committed zina, so decide the case. Otherwise, the general rule about kuffar coming in and worshipping in the masajid is that they are not permitted. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says in Surah At-Tawbah, مَا كَانَ لِلْمُشْرِكِينَ أَن يَعْمُرُوا مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ شَاهِدِينَ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ بِالْكُفْرِ أُولَٰئِكَ حَبِضَتْ أَعْمَالُهُمْ وَفِي النَّارِ هُمْ خَالِدُونَ. It is not fitting for the mushrikeen to populate the masajid of Allah whilst they testify against themselves that they are kuffar. They are the ones whose deeds have become nullified or gone to waste, and they will abide in the fire forever. So he's saying that the kuffar cannot be worshipping in the masajid of Allah because their deeds have gone to waste. So how can somebody whose deeds have gone to waste be worshipping in the masajid? And this is the person who witnesses against himself that he's a kafir and he's not a Muslim, and he will be in the hellfire forever. So how can a person like this now be populating the masajid by performing his acts of worship? This is not permissible. Then he goes on, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدَ اللَّهِ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَأَقَامَ الصَّلَاةَ وَآتَ الزَّكَاةَ وَلَمْ يَخْشَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَعَسَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ أَنْ يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ. The only ones who populate the masajid of Allah are the ones who have iman in Allah and the last day, and he establishes the salah and he gives the zakah, and he does not fear anyone except Allah. So hopefully it is they who will be the rightly guided. So the worship in the masajid of Allah can only be carried out by proper Muslims. It cannot be carried out by ones whose deeds have gone to waste.
So as for the haram, then it is clear-cut. The kuffar are not allowed in the haram area. But as for the other masajid, then the correct and balanced view is that the kufar are allowed in other masajid if it serves the interest of Islam, for example, educating the kufar about what Islam is, and that they may see how to properly worship Allah Jalla wa'ala. So for these types of da'wah purposes or educational purposes, then that is fine. As evidence, we know, for example, the Prophet allowed the delegation of Thaqif and the Christians of Najran to stay in the masjid of the Prophet. And this was all aimed towards giving them da'wah, as it was hoped that they would embrace the deen. Okay, let us take a few review questions. Question number one. What is the reason for the Prophet prohibiting removing a pebble in the salah? We mentioned two possible reasons. Recall them. Question number two. Give the detail about changing your intention during the salah from nafila to fard and vice versa. Question number three. Why is it prohibited to have graves in the masjid or to build a masajid on a grave?